Now I will show you pseudo code with proper looping. I am showing you the main part of the code. I am not showing you the complete pseudo code. So the main loops which are involved, I am showing you. It is just that you have to use a particular programming language and convert into the as per the language syntax. So this pseudo code, what I am showing you right now is when you apply x momentum equation to obtain u velocity. In this slide I am showing you steps to predict u velocity. Now to predict u velocity, this is the expression to calculate the mass fluxes in the x direction, this is the expression to calculate the mass fluxes in the y direction. Note that to calculate mass flux in case of x momentum control volume, you have to do linear interpolations. These are the expression to calculate the momentum flux in the x direction and momentum flux in the y direction. This is the expression to calculate the viscous force in the x direction on vertical faces, which is a normal viscous stress. This is the expression to calculate the shear viscous stress in the x direction. Note the difference in the loop, running indices of the loop. Once you have calculated this fluxes, then you know there is a step, there is an expression where you do a balance, multiply by delta V divided by, and then add that with the velocity of the previous time step. You do calculate total advection, which is the rate at which x momentum is lost by the fluid in the control volume. Let me see, I think it is right now east phase minus west phase. So this is x momentum lost by the fluid in the control volume. This is the total viscous force acting in the x direction. So now we are doing a balance, and this is the total pressure force acting in the x direction. Note that for pressure in x momentum we are not doing any interpolations. And finally to predict u velocity. Similarly, I had shown you animation for this. This is the steps to calculate the fluxes, momentum fluxes, viscous forces, viscous stresses in the x direction, this is in the y direction. Sorry, the viscous stresses will be the shear viscous stress here, and this will be the normal viscous stress, but both the viscous stress will be in the y direction only, because viscous force we have to take in y direction in y momentum equation. Once you have calculated these fluxes, you calculate the total term, do a balance, and then predict v velocity. So that completes the pseudo code for velocity prediction. First we predict fluxes, and then we obtain, then we predict velocities. Now here I will show you expression to do mass balance. So once we have predicted the velocities, we use those velocities and calculate mass imbalance, which is represented here as divergence, net mass going out of the control volume, mass source. This epsilon is what we call as practically zero, which a user has to define. If the mass source has become practically zero, then whatever velocity you have predicted is the correct velocity for the next time step, and you can go for computation of temperature in case of force convection heat transfer problem. If it has not, then you solve for pressure correction as a function of mass imbalance as shown here. You add the pressure correction to the earlier pressure and obtain a, so this is a basically a pressure tuning. You get an updated value of pressure, and from an updated value of pressure you get an updated value of the velocities, updated value of mass fluxes, and with that updated value of mass fluxes, check again the mass imbalance. If mass imbalance is close to 0, then you are converged, otherwise you keep doing pressure tuning, new mass imbalance. So this continues till convergence. Note here that even if you are using a semi-explicit method in for unsteady formulation, there is one loop for time matching where you will generate pictures at every different time step, and you can create a movie for the velocity and temperature distribution. There is an inner loop also. Which is that inner loop? This pressure tuning and mass updation, mass flow rate updation. So, I will note that continuity equation, as there is no explicit equation for pressure, needs to be solved iteratively, and that is the biggest difficulty in computational fluid dynamics. This is for temperature. I have shown you the grid points at the cell center and phase centers. This is to calculate the mass flux, enthalpy flux and conduction heat flux in the x and y direction, the pseudo code. And this is to balance the net enthalpy lost by the fluid in the control volume, total heat gained by conduction, total heat gained by volumetric heat generation. So, this is the total heat gain. You multiply by dt divided by rho Cp into volume, you get a some temperature which you add with the temperature of the previous time step, and obtain the temperature of the new time step. Okay, so this staggered grid is one of the remedy. It works well in the standard coordinate system problems, but when you go to the complex geometry, we have to come up with another formulation which is called as collocated grid formulation. I would like to mention that nowadays one method which is becoming very popular, which is the method which was the first method in the for CFD computation. So, one method which is a Cartesian grid method, which was probably the first method with which CFD started. Now, that method is again becoming popular nowadays, because there is an issue that if you are solving industrial problem which has a very complex geometry, three dimensional problems, and nowadays there are more complex problem like moving boundary problems, then after each time step when you have to regenerate the mesh, like for flow across a car or an aeroplane, mesh generation takes lot of computational time. If it is not moving, then you generate mesh only, but just imagine it is a moving boundary problem, then you have to generate that mesh after every time step. So, when you use this body fitted curvilinear grid, structured or unstructured, it takes lot of time in mesh generation. So, one of the oldest method in CFD, Cartesian grid method, is nowadays becoming popular due to this reason. However, if you are using Cartesian grid for, let us say, flow across a car or aeroplane where the surface is curved, solid surface is curved, then you generate Cartesian control volume where there are certain control volume which are partially filled by solid and by liquid. So, if at formulation stage we are somehow able to handle this partially filled cells by properly applying the boundary conditions at the solid fluid interface, then it is a very promising option. There is another approach which is becoming quite popular, which was called as adaptive multi-level Cartesian grid method. Probably towards the end of today's lecture, I will show you, we are working on developing that method. So, maybe I will show you an animation for that. So, I would like to say that maybe you see lot of unstructured grid or a curvilinear grid for industrial problem, but right now here you are learning a Cartesian grid method, but this method is coming, is gaining lot of importance nowadays. Because in this Cartesian grid method, when there is a partially filled cells which we mentioned, even if the object is moving, what will change is that the partially filled change may next time, let us say, it can go in completely in solid or it can go completely in fluid. So you may have new partially filled cells. So you have to keep a tag of the cells which are being partially filled. But your grid, Cartesian grid, does not change with respect to time. So you don't have to do remeshing. And moreover, generating body fitted grid in a, let us say, car or aeroplane versus generating Cartesian grid which is not body fitted, you can, the computational time requirement for mesh generation, there is a lot of difference. This Cartesian grid generation doesn't take almost any time. In this slide, I am showing you, as we are having pressure Poisson equation for pressure correction, it's like a conduction equation, so you need boundary condition at all the boundaries. So in here I am showing you the boundary conditions for pressure corrections. And the boundaries where pressure is defined, like in outflow, if pressure is prescribed, then the pressure corrections become 0. So for any boundary where pressure is given, pressure correction is 0. In most of the solid boundary, in fact all the solid boundary, you know there is one boundary condition which even comes from an implicit flow. No slip boundary condition comes from viscous flow. What is the boundary condition even in implicit flow? Normal velocity is equal to 0. So in a solid boundary, normal velocity correction is equal to 0. And if you go back and look into the expression for velocity corrections, the way we have proposed, if the normal velocity correction is equal to 0, what you will get is the normal gradient of pressure correction should be 0. So in the solid boundaries, your normal gradient of pressure correction is taken as 0 as a boundary condition. So on the left boundary, right boundary and bottom boundary, which are solid boundary, normal gradient of pressure correction, these are the discrete form of the normal gradient of pressure correction, is equal to 0. On this stationary boundaries, u and v are 0, so that is what is shown here. On the top boundary, a is 1, v is 0, and even if it is a top boundary, it is a solid boundary, so there is no velocity, normal velocity will be 0, so normal gradient of pressure correction is 0 here also. Okay, so after starting with the finite volume method, moving on to formulations for both semi-explicit and semi-implementation, semi-explicit as well as semi-implicit method, then discussing the implementation details of the semi-explicit method with pseudo codes. Finally, let me discuss the solution algorithm. So the solution algorithm for semi-explicit method is that we start with the user input, which is common to all the solution algorithm discussed in the earlier lecture, that is material property, thermophysical properties, geometrical parameter, maximum number of control volumes in x and y directions, what is the type of boundary conditions and what are the input corresponding to a boundary condition. This epsilon, which are two things here, which is convergence criteria as far as mass balance is concerned, and it is a steadiness criteria for steady state if you want to stop your computations. Then grid generation, we calculate all the geometrical parameters. Delta t, if you are using a semi-explicit method, I had mentioned that we do not have a one equation for the time step restriction in a semi-explicit method in case of Navier Stokes equation. We have one equation for pure conduction. We have one equation for delta t as a function of delta x and delta y and u velocity and v velocity of the grid point for pure advection. So for pure conduction and pure advection, we have separate equations. So we calculate one delta t for pure conduction in pure diffusion in this case, second time step for pure advection. So we get two time step and we take the minimum of the two. Note that these are just as a guidelines. They are not sufficient or guaranteed that they will work. Okay, because this Navier Stokes equation is not pure diffusion equation, it is not pure advection equation, it is the combination of the two, but we do not have, we cannot do a stability analysis for this nonlinear equations, okay. So that way delta T is calculated. I discussed this in detail in the chapter of computational heat convection. Set the initial condition for phi, which will be u velocity, v velocity and temperature, set the boundary condition. When you go for the next computation, set the value as a old value, then first taking this phi as u, there will be one subroutine for advection flux, diffusion flux, you send phi is equals to u, gamma is equals to dynamic viscosity, c is equals to 1. Calculate fluxes in the x and y directions using velocity of the previous time level. Calculate the total force acting in the x direction as a source term. Calculate total advection, total diffusion and predict u velocity. Similarly do for v velocity, okay. So for v velocity repeat this step 7 to 10. So with that you have predicted u velocity and v velocity. And then you check how much is the mass imbalance. If it is close to 0, then you have got the correct velocity. Otherwise, calculate pressure correction as a function of mass imbalance, add that pressure correction to the previous pressure and get an updated value of pressure. So this is a pressure tuning which is happening. Once you get a new pressure, then the mass flux correction, then there is a velocity correction from which you can calculate the mass flux correction, by which the mass flux, predicted mass flux is updated. When you update the predicted mass flux, you get a new mass imbalance. Here note that you have to go back to step 2 and this step 12 to 15 continues till mass balance occurs. And then this predicted, so once you have obeyed the mass balance, the predicted star velocity which you have obtained, that become the velocity for the next time step. Then you solve the energy equation if it is a force convection problem and you check for steady state, otherwise go to step 5 and continue till steady state. So after discussing all the formulation, as I say that even if you use all this formulation, implementation detail, solution algorithm, you will develop a product. What is that product? A CFD software. But to make it to a CFD software, here what I am discussing is what are the main core things as far as fluid mechanics and heat transfer is concerned. To convert into full fledged software, you need other things also which are more related with the computer science aspects. But once you have developed the core of the which are related with fluid mechanics and heat transfer as far as programming is concerned, you have to test it, then only your product will be accepted by the people in the market. So that is what is called as test problems or benchmark problems. So yesterday in the lab session, you have solved these problems. We have given you the product which is the code, which is the set of programs, and you have solved it for four different cases. First, isothermal flow where there is no heat transfer, everywhere temperature is ambient, and then convective heat transfer problem, three different types of convective heat transfer problem. Force convection, which is a approximation. What is the approximation in force convection? Buoyancy induced flow is negligible as compared to the force flow, and in this case there is a one-way coupling between the momentum and energy equation. Energy equation is anyway dependent on the flow, but the flow is not dependent on the heat transfer. Whereas in case of mixed convection, both fluid flow and the buoyancy induced flow are of comparable magnitude. In this case, in the momentum equation, there is a source term which is a function of temperature. Whereas when you go to the natural convection, the buoyancy induced flow is dominant. So you have solved various problem corresponding to these four situations. After the tea break, I will discuss these various problems one by one. And before I end, I would like to say that sorry you have to appear for the quiz yesterday twice due to some problem in our server. We sincerely apologize for the inconvenience. Many of you might be feeling that you had completed first time and you had to appear second time. This is just to, we had certain issues as far as grading is concerned. So that was the reason you had to go through the second time also. As there were many questions, there were total 45 questions and the questions were randomized and you had to solve 30 questions. So probably when you had appeared for the second time, at least few of the questions were new to you. Even if it was a repetition, I hope it would have been refreshing or re-emphasizing the concepts which you had learned. I hope that the problems in the quiz will help you in better understanding of what has been taught here. We are on the topic on solution of Navier Stokes equation on staggered grid. Now we will discuss some test problems which you have attempted in yesterday's lab session. The objective of showing this is also because there were many requests from you that we should, if we can highlight the research opportunities as well as aspects in computational fluid dynamics. So as the primary objective of this workshop is on teaching, so we would not be able to showcase whatever CFD research we are doing. For that you can refer to our research paper from our websites. However, we would highlight certain aspects as far as research in CFD is concerned through these problems. There are two aspects of research in computational fluid dynamics: CFD development, where you come up with a new method for a particular heat transfer or fluid flow problem, or improve an existing method. And the second aspect is of research in CFD is CFD analysis. That is, once you have developed a code or a software, you run that for some problem, you set up a problem, set up a domain, generate grid, and then each problem has certain governing parameters. Note that in research we do non-dimensional analysis, so there will be certain non-dimensional governing parameters. And you might have noticed that in the four problems which you had solved in yesterday lab sessions, the problem was proposed in a generic sense where there were certain things which was explained to you, that what is code validation, what is benchmarking. It was also mentioned the governing parameters which are involved in the various problems discussed here, which will be discussed here, was shown to you: the Reynolds number, Grashof number, Prandtl number. And yesterday lab session you had solved using non-dimensional analysis. So each problem, like flow across a cylinder, if you consider, what are the governing parameters? What are the non-dimensional governing parameters? For flow across a cylinder, the non-dimensional governing parameter is Reynolds number. So one of the CFD research as far as that problem is concerned is people vary that Reynolds number and then they try to see two things. They capture, let us say, CFD movies for velocity distribution, pressure distribution, vorticity distribution, and it is a heat transfer problem, temperature distribution, and then try to have a physical understanding of the flow physics. Understanding of the flow physics, you will get different types of flow structures. What is the role of this flow structures on the engineering parameters? This is something which is always aimed at. So any CFD studies which you do, the overall objective, the bigger objective is to study the nature or characteristics of the flow structures, characteristics of the flow which is reflected by the flow structures, and try to correlate, because what happens is that depending upon the range of governing parameter, you may get certain, let us say, reduction in drag force or increase in lift force. Now, the reason why that reduction or that increase is happening, as a part of research, we try to investigate the flow structure, and the objective is to connect the flow structure to the reason why increase or decrease of engineering parameter is happening. So, the first problem which you had solved in yesterday lab session was an isothermal flow problem, lid driven cavity flow, which I had explained in my earlier slides. Note that the characteristic length scale taken here is the size of the square cavity. Note that the length and height of the cavity is same. The characteristic velocity in this problem is the velocity with which lid is moving. In this problem, there is only one length scale and only one velocity scale. So, it is easy to decide what is the characteristic length scale and characteristic velocity scale. But there are many problems, or most of the problems in real world, you find there are more than one length scale. Like if you take flow across a cylinder in a pipe or in a plain channel, there are two length scale. Let us say diameter of the pipe and the size of the cylinder. Now, when you take up that problem, one confusion which is there is whether you should take the diameter of the cylinder as the characteristic length scale or diameter of the pipe as the characteristic length scale. So, in that case, what you do is that you try to see whether the pipe is very far away from the cylinder, then the diameter of the cylinder is a good characteristic length scale. But if the diameter of the pipe is slightly more than that of the cylinder, then probably you should take the diameter of the pipe as the length scale. And many times what we do is that we look into the research paper on that particular problem, and from there we try to take an idea or guideline that what is the length scale he has used, and accordingly once we are convinced, we use that as a length scale or a velocity scale. Now, whenever you do a CFD analysis, so once you have developed a code, tested a code, you take up a problem and then you run your code. And in general, there are two types of results. First, which is called as a qualitative results, where we create movies for, let us say, velocity vectors, streamlines. Right now, here what I will be showing you is the steady state profile. So, this pictures, or if you create a movie with, that is animation, this gives us qualitative information. Okay. Here I will show you the variation of u velocity along the vertical center line. Let me go to the previous slide and then discuss. How is the nature of the flow? In this case, the lid is like a conveyor belt which is moving from left to right. So, the top wall is having a velocity u naught. Now, that I had taken this example when I was discussing physical interpretation of kinematic viscosity, where I talk about penetration depth, where I said that if the depth of this cavity is infinite, then this momentum is penetrated up to certain depth at certain time step. However, with increase in time, that penetration depth increases. And I had mentioned that penetration depth is directly proportional to square root of kinematic viscosity. So, the momentum is diffused or penetrated to the bottom layers, and the fluid moves with the maximum velocity at the top. At the corner, it cannot go out, so it turns. When it turns, it goes downward, but there is a viscous resistance from the bottom fluid which is stationary. So, there is a second turn and you get a clockwise vortex. Now, when there is a clockwise vortex, in this this is called as a benchmark problem, because whenever we develop our code, we compare our results with an accurate experimental or numerical result. So for this, there is one result which is considered very accurate, which was published by Ghia and Shin, and the results which they have given in a tabular form, which we can use for comparison, is the variation of u velocity on vertical center line. So this is the vertical center line passing through the cavity. So as you move from bottom to top, what will be the direction of u velocity? Of course, on the top portion it will be in the positive x direction, because it will be having the effect of this conveyor belt. And what will be the velocity at penetration depth? Slowly this velocity will keep reducing, and as you know that there is a clockwise vortex. So on the bottom half, the direction of the velocity will be negative. So on the top portion you have a positive velocity, and on the bottom portion, as there is a clockwise vortex, it will be negative. So there is change in the direction of u velocity from positive to negative as you move from top to bottom in the vertical center line. Similarly, if you look into the variation of v velocity on horizontal center line. So on horizontal center line, when you have a clockwise vertex, near to the left wall, the direction of v velocity will be upward, positive. And near to the right wall, the direction of the fluid will be downward. So there is change in the velocity as you move from left to right on the horizontal center line for v velocity. Initially the v velocity is positive, then it becomes 0, and then it becomes negative. So other than this plots, we generate data from our in-house code, which we have developed through the formulation, implementation, detail, solution algorithm discussed here, and compare our result with the published result. Right now the result is shown for 3 different grid size. Note that in yesterday lab session you had solved the problem on a very coarse grid size. This is just so that you should not feel that it is taking too time and you become impatient. We have given you a grid size so that you get a quick result. But in that lab sheet I had written that if you want a very accurate solution, you have to be patient and you have to keep running the code for a long time. Maybe you can start the code even in the night before sleeping, and you can watch the result after in the morning. So it may take as large as time as this. Note that the Scilab, the program we had written in Scilab, one of the primary objective is that this is an open source software first, and second, it is easy to go through the programs in Scilab. It is almost like a pseudo code. The programming language in fact is very easy, and in fact it is very easy whenever you run the Scilab. The Scilab is very much similar to the commercial software MATLAB, and it is not only easy to program. Actually here one good thing is that you do not have to declare variables. It automatically takes the size of the variables, like in Fortran or C you have to declare whether it is an integer or real, whether it is a single precision or double precision. You have to declare the size of the variable if it is a matrix. So all those things you do not have to do in this programming language. So with this Scilab you can understand the program. However, as compared to the conventional programming language like C and Fortran, I would tell you that if you develop the same program in C or Fortran, it will take less computational time as compared to the Scilab code. The reason being, this Scilab, the way it runs the code is that it does not create an executable files, and every time it loads all the variables and runs in each iteration, so it takes more computational time. However, the objective was to get you started as far as programming is concerned, and we believe that you should be able to convert this Scilab code into, let us say, C, C++ or Fortran, whichever language you want to convert to. And in fact, one other good thing about this Scilab is that when you are developing a program, like if your result is not coming, what you do is that you try to insert print statement in between the lines in the program. you have to insert write statement in the C language and Fortran language to print some variable. But here in Scilab, you do not have to do that. You just have to write the name of the variable in the command window. Because once this is run, all the variable is stored in its memory. So that is why it takes more computational time as compared to C program or a Fortran program for the same method, whether it is a conduction, advection, convection or Navier Stokes. Okay, so there are certain disadvantage of whether you use a Scilab or MATLAB versus C program or Fortran program. But we felt that right now our objective is to make you understand taking some simple CFD problems. So that is why we decided that you will develop program in Scilab. Another good thing is that we had a problem that if we had given you code in C or Fortran, then you need another software for plotting. Otherwise, we have to develop the graphical user interface in our program, which is more of a computer science job, which we normally do not do. So that way we decided this Scilab is another good thing is that it has its own inbuilt graphics. So that way we decided upon this. Now this is the steady state result. Now what are the things which you are seeing in this figure? There is a color, there is a white line and there are arrows. There are three things. What does the color represents? Color represents flooded contour of stream function. Line represents streamlines along with their values, and the arrows represents which is what is called as vector plot. What is this vector plot? Once you, let us suppose you have obtained the steady state velocity distribution. Let us suppose you have 100 points in the domain. So you get 100 u velocity, 100 v velocity, and corresponding to those points there is some x coordinate, y coordinate. So you have 100 x coordinate, 100 y coordinate, 100 u velocities and 100 v velocities. This is the numbers you have got, which you have stored in a data structure matrix. Now what you do is that you take this data to a plotting software. Like if you are in Scilab, as when you run it stores in the memory, it is already there in the memory. So in the program, if you use a plot command, it plots it. Otherwise, if you are using a program C or Fortran as a programming language, and if you have not developed graphical user interface, then you store this data in a data structure which is required by a particular graphical software, and then you take it to that software, plot it and then visualize the result. So with that data, when there is a velocity distribution, what vector plot represent is that at different grid points, if there are 100 points corresponding to those 100 points, when you talk of velocity, it is a vector quantity, and vector we represent by some magnitude, direction and sense. So what this software, graphical software does is that it does some scaling. Okay, maybe let us say the maximum value of the data, maximum value of the resultant velocity, it does a scaling. Let us suppose that will be represented by 1 centimeter. And with that relative scaling, depending upon the magnitude of the resultant velocity, it creates a length of this vector. And as each point, not only we have magnitude, we can calculate the orientation of the vector also. So the software does that also and then draws the at each grid point vectors. That is what is shown in this vector plot. Many a time this vector plot, if you draw, you do not get a good feel of the flow structure most of the time. You get an idea that okay, at some location the velocity is low. Here you can say that the velocity is low in the bottom region, velocity is high in the top region. But as far as the overall idea about the vortex formations, many a time you have a very fine grid and this vector fills the region completely. This arrows overlap over each other in space. So it becomes very difficult to understand. So that is why in fluid dynamics or CFD, one picture or one movie is not sufficient to give us the complete story about what is happening to the fluid flow. So if you want to know, if you want to understand the vortex, it is better to draw the stream lines. For that, what we do is that we post process this velocity information, because you know what is the relationship between a stream function and a velocity, like u is equals to del psi by del y. So what we do is that we do a numerical differentiation and we express psi 2 minus psi 1 is equals to, so once you know the velocity, you do the numerical differentiation and you can calculate the stream function values at different. Normally the way we do is that we velocity are defined at the centroid of the control volume, then we calculate the stream function at the faces of the control volume, face centers of the control volume. Once you have, so stream functions are calculated by a method which is called as post processing. So once we have got the converged, let us say steady state solution, then we used the discrete form of the expression for stream function as a function of velocity gradient, and we calculate, let us say if there are 100 point, we calculate the stream function values, and then once we have got that data, we take it to a software and we use a command what is called as contour command, and then we get the streamlines. Okay, so this is the way it is drawn. So from the streamlines, one thing which you can see is that there is a, although the streamline is not showing you the direction, whether it is a clockwise vortex or is an anticlockwise vortex, that you get from vector plot. Okay, so some information is given by the velocity vectors, some other information is given by the streamline. So the story about the characteristics of the flow, we get different stories or different aspects of the characteristics with different types of plot. This is what you can understand and appreciate through this figure. Right now I am showing you for a particular problem, but this is applicable, what I am discussing is quite generic in nature, and this is applicable to any CFD problem when you are doing a CFD analysis. Note that you can use a CFD software or CFD code which you have developed. You can know what are the governing parameter, like in this case I can say Reynolds number is the governing parameter. Note that in earlier in the lab session we had told you to run the code on 2 Reynolds number. So like a, so if you want to do a research, you can keep increasing the Reynolds number from 100 to 400 to 1000, and you can, what you will slowly see is that the size of this, here you will see there is a corner vortex which is formed. The size of this corner vortex will keep on increasing with the increase in the size of the Reynolds number. So with the increase in the governing parameter, you see that change, there is a change in the flow structure. Now this change in the flow structure has a, creates its effect on the engineering parameters. Like what is the engineering parameter in this problem? Wall shear stress, near to the bottom wall, top wall, or let us say top. Like if there is a conveyor belt, there is some energy which is spent in moving this conveyor belt, and there is a resistance, there is a viscous force which is opposing its motion. So let us say there is an engineering parameter that how much energy needs to be spent to move the conveyor belt. And as you increase the Reynolds number, the velocity gradient near to the wall of the conveyor belt will increase, so the shear resistance will increase. Okay, so that is the engineering parameter in this problem. Note that this engineering parameter varies from problem to problem, like flow across an aeroplane, it is the lift force and drag force, which is there for most of the external flow problem, and for most of the internal flow problem, the wall shear stress, whose non-dimensional representation is a skin friction coefficient, is an engineering parameter. Also when you have an open domain internal flow, pressure drop is an important engineering parameter. Okay, all these engineering parameter are obtained once you have obtained a converged solution of the velocities and pressure distribution by doing numerical differentiation to calculate the local values, like at the wall, if I want to calculate the wall shear stress, analogously we had calculated the local heat flux at the boundary grid points in case of conduction problem. So to calculate local heat flux at the boundary grid point or local wall shear stress at the boundary grid point, you have to do numerical differentiation, because heat flux and wall shear stress are expressed by Fourier law of heat conduction and Newton law of viscosity, where they are expressed in terms of gradients of temperature and velocity respectively. Now, here you are having number which are discrete, and although the expression is a differential expression, here you have to do numerical differentiation. Now, when you want to calculate total shear force, let us say in this case, or total heat gained by conduction from a particular wall, when you want to calculate total value, then you know that you have to do integration, and as the data here is discrete, you have to do numerical integration. So, in a numerical method course, it is a good idea that when you are teaching a topic on numerical differentiation or numerical integration, you take example from fluid mechanics and heat transfer. In fact, here we have two courses. First course, which we call as computational methods in thermal and fluid engineering, where we teach all this numerical differentiation, numerical integration, solution of linear algebraic equations on the first half of the course. In the second half of the course, we teach complete finite difference method applied to starting from pure conduction and then moving on to steam function vorticity formulation and even Navier Stokes equation on staggered grid. And we have a second course which we call as computational fluid flow and heat transfer, computational fluid dynamics and heat transfer, where we teach finite volume method. So, whatever I have taught here, it constitutes approximately 40% to 50% of that course, and another 50% consists of solution of Navier Stokes equation on a collocated grid, complex geometry formulation, grid generation. So, this is the figure showing the results. So, the using all the details which have been discussed earlier, code is developed, and that code is run on 3 different grid sizes. Here right now, variation of u velocity on vertical center line is shown. You can see on the bottom half u is negative and on the top half u is positive as per our expectation. Red line represent the results obtained on a grid size of 11 by 11, green line on a grid size of 31 by 31, and blue line on a grid size of 15 by 15. Okay. Now, what the purpose of this figure is to show you that, as many of you were asking question that how do we know that what is the grid, sufficient grid. So, as each fluid dynamics problem has its own action, I had answered that we do not know how much grid is enough, because that enough word is a relative word. Okay, I had given an analogy that let us suppose you want to capture some phenomena which is changing with respect to time. So, let us say water flowing in a river versus let us suppose an explosion. Now, to capture, if you want to create a movie, you need a video camera which has a very fine, very large frame rate to capture the details of the explosion, how the shock is generated during explosion. Whereas, even with a normal camera, you can at least pictorially get the flow of water in a river. So, analogously here, each fluid flow situation has its own action. So, how much frame rate you need, how much pixel or resolution or grid size you need for a particular problem, you do not know a priori most of the time. You try to take guidance from the published literature, where someone has done earlier, taken the same problem, although he may have done for some other governing parameter. So, you can get guideline from the previous published results, but you have to do this exercise to convince people that the results which you have obtained is accurate enough. Note that in a research paper, code validation, even if you are using a software, the people who have developed the software, they might have validated. But when you are using, you have to show that you are using the software correctly. So, even if you are using a software and you are doing a CFD analysis, if you want to publish your result in an international journal or conference, there are 2 very important things which you have to show to convince people in your result. First is code validation, which I am showing you in this slide. And second is grid independence, which also I am showing through this slide. So both the things I am showing through this slide. So here what is meant by grid independence is that as you refine the grid, it can be seen that the difference between the results between 31 by 31 is large, and the difference is negligible between 31 by 31 and 51 by 51. So you can write down that 31 by 31 is small enough to obtain the results which are accurate enough and obtain the result which is called as grid independent solution. These black circles are the results which have been taken from a research paper which is commonly used for code validation, and you can see that the blue and green line are lying almost on the top of it. So this way you can convince people that you have got an accurate, your code is giving accurate results. And if you are using a software, you have to convince that you are using the software correctly, because this software usage, there is a lot of things which requires understanding. As I had mentioned that for flow across a car and our airplane, if you take the size of the external size of, there are two boundary for such case, inner boundary which is covering the surface of car or airplane, and outer boundary which is the far field boundary. Now, if your far field boundary is too small, then the effect of boundary condition from the far field will distort the result near to the solid boundary. So you also have to show domain size independent study in that case. So these are some of the things which comes because, as you know, theory is something which nobody believes except the person proposing the theory, and CFD is of course a theoretical method. So these are all the things which we do, like grid independence, code validation, domain independent study, if it is a transient problem, time step independent study also, to make to convince people that whatever results you are obtaining is accurate enough. Once you have convinced, then you can start with two aspects of the study. First is the scientific aspects, where you look into the pictures or create movies for the flow and try to have a qualitative description of the characteristics of the flow, quantify the structures of the flow, and then you, second aspect is you do a quantitative analysis where you plot results, which I will show for this problem in the next slides. In this figure, what I am showing you is the code validation, but here it is a variation of V velocity on the horizontal center line. Now, here again you can see that the result obtained by 11 by 11 grid, the difference between the result on 11 by 11 and 31 by 31 is large, whereas the difference between this blue and the green, which is obtained on 51 by 51 and 31 by 31 is less. So this shows that as you refine the grid, there is a change in the result, but the change is asymptotic in nature. What is meant by asymptotic? Note, what is the difference between 11 by 11 and 31 by 31? 20 is the difference in the, so 20 nodes you are increasing in the x direction when you change from 11 to 31. When you change from 31 to 51, again you are changing the 20 nodes. But the change in the results which you see, initially there is a large change, and that change slowly dies down as you refine the grid. So the difference asymptotes, so that is the nature of with which of the grid refinement. So the change should be monotonic and it should asymptote. So that was about the qualitative analysis. There is a second aspect of the study which is called as quantitative analysis. So CFD has two types of analysis, qualitative analysis and quantitative analysis. Qualitative analysis, we write which results which you use for qualitative analysis, pictures or movies of the flow field. And in quantitative, which results which we discuss engineering parameters. Like in this case, variation of skin friction coefficient. The skin friction coefficient is non-dimensional wall shear stress. It is expressed as tau w divided by half rho u naught square. U naught is the lid velocity. So variation of local skin friction coefficient along the different walls of the cavity at 52 by 52 grid is shown here. Variation of mean skin friction coefficient on different walls of the cavity. So this is the local value, this is the mean value. Next slide shows you the local value. So this is the non-dimensional wall shear stress variation on the left wall. The green line represents the same parameter on the right wall. You can correlate that why this is positive and why this is negative by carefully looking into the direction of the velocity near to the respective walls. Now, on different grid sizes, this corresponds to the grid size of 12 by 12, where delta x is 0.1, the domain size is 1, so 1 divided by 10, it is 0.1. This is the grid size for 32 by 32, so 1 divided by 30 is this, 1 divided by 50 is this. So, here grid size means delta x, which is also equal to delta y for the present problem. So, as you refine the grid, what you see is that there is a change in the results. So, here again we expect that the change in the results should asymptote. That was for an isothermal flow, there had shown a much more details of the result. In the other problem, I will just show you the physical description of the problem and the mathematical equations. I will not discuss the results for the remaining problem. So, here the problem which I had discussed earlier was isothermal flow. Now, it is the same problem. Now, the difference is left wall, bottom wall and top wall, the boundary condition is that they are maintained at a temperature which is less than that of the hot wall. So, top wall is hot as compared to the other walls, constant wall temperature. Now, in this case, note that you have a forced flow, why there is a forced flow which is created, why? Due to the motion of this lead. If this lead is stationary, then it becomes a natural convection problem. As this lead is moving, if it is moving with very large velocity and if the temperature difference is small, then it can, you can even neglect the buoyancy induced flow and it will become a forced convection heat transfer problem. Whereas, if the temperature difference is large, buoyancy effects will be more, and if the Reynolds number is also large, both effects will be, cannot be neglected, and then it becomes a mixed convection problem. Whereas, if the wall, this lead is stationary, then the force flow, you do not have any force flow and there you have only buoyancy induced flow, then it becomes a natural convection problem. So, for this case, which is a forced or mixed convection heat transfer problem, where we are having lead which is having a non-zero velocity, this is the governing equation for which you have been given the lab sheet. So, note that here in this case, what is the diffusion coefficient? 1 divided by Reynolds number for momentum equation. And what is the diffusion coefficient for energy equation? 1 divided by Reynolds number into Prandtl number. What is the body force term when it is a mixed convection problem? Note that here momentum equation has a temperature term. So, now it has become two-way coupling. Velocity depends on temperature, temperature anyway depends upon the velocity. In force convection case, this is close to 0. So, I think in your lab sheet, you have to solve one case where Grashof number is 0. Grashof number 0 means this term 0, then it becomes a forced convection heat transfer problem. And for non-zero values of Grashof number, then it becomes a mixed convection heat transfer problem. And these are the expression, Reynolds number is ratio of inertia force to viscous force, Grashof number that of buoyancy force and viscous force. You also have a Prandtl number as a non-dimensional governing parameter. So, if you want to study this problem, you have, let us say, 3 tuning parameters. What are those 3 tuning parameters? How do we decide that how many parameters we have? By looking into this non-dimensional equation and non-dimensional governing parameter. Note that there are 2 types of parameter, governing parameter and engineering parameter. Governing parameter is an input parameter, engineering parameter is an output parameter. Reynolds number is 1 non-dimensional governing parameter, Grashof number is the second and Prandtl number is the third governing parameter. So if you want to do a detailed investigation, you need to vary the Reynolds number, Prandtl number and Grashof number, and you can do a detailed scientific as well as engineering study analyzing the qualitatively and quantitatively. Now here lead, there is no lead, top wall is also stationary. Now this has become a natural convection heat transfer problem. And the boundary condition which has been given is top wall and bottom wall there is a constant heat flux, left wall is at hotter temperature is more as compared to the cold wall, right wall. Now note that in earlier case, actually I had not written here non-dimensional temperature, but this is mostly defined as T minus TH divided by T minus TH divided by TC minus TH. You can define in different ways. The two ways is that in one case you will get a non-dimensional value of temperature as 1 on the top wall, hot wall, and 0 on the cold walls. You can define in another way also where you can get 1 in the cold wall and 0 in the hot wall. Now here the non-dimensional in natural convection, as lead velocity, lead is not moving, all walls are stationary, there is no characteristic velocity as far as the problem is concerned. So in this problem, we have defined characteristic velocity as alpha divided by L. What is alpha? Thermal diffusivity. And the length scale is the length of the plate. And in this case, when you do non-dimensionalization, considering this as the non-dimensional velocity, you end up with this non-dimensional equation. And in this non-dimensional equation, the non-dimensional governing parameters are two parameters, one is Rayleigh number and second is Prandtl number. So with this I had come to the end of this topic.